the sales were due to the sale of cathode copper, 43.5, and around a third were due to water loss here, 27%. Now, cost estimation. By costs, we generally mean the costs of production here. And here's some categories of costs, for example, supplies, services, and etc. Now, the recent economic crisis and the collapse of copper prices led to the closure of many inefficient and ineffective copper plants around the world. To that end, rapid change in industry and improvements of technology means that it is imperative for producers to understand drivers of profitability and sustainability for businesses. This is again a breakdown of the cost of the costs of this company. Note that the overheads comprise nearly half of the total, no, 40% of the total costs. Also 800 million dollars were the total costs, which you should be reminded that the average profits for 3 years were $750 million. Now, as I said, over costs were about 40% of the total. Overhead costs are those costs which are necessary for the continuation of the business of a company, but which do not directly result into profits. For example, these include energy, land, repairs, everything. And not everything, but it is not until sub list. Now, these are the overhead costs. We have examined most of them, but you can see that depreciation and stripping result to over 55% of the overhead costs. We may look at these costs and try to alleviate some of them in order to make the business more efficient. As part of this analysis, we must predict the price and calculate the break-even point in order to understand the impact of price fluctuations on our company. Now, as demand from China and India increases, the copper supplies are limited and stretched, and this has resulted in an increase in the price of metals around the world. This graph here shows the price from 2000 until 2010. Notes that there has been a sharp increase here between 2005 and 2007, where it peaked and then it dropped until 8,780,000, and then it dropped in 2008, which we attribute to the financial crisis. And we can see that it has had a very good and healthy recovery ever since. Now, we want to know the present value of a future project in order to assess its likely profitability. For that, we calculate the NPV. In other words, we calculate the time value of money. To do so, data has been extracted from financial statements and tabulated. In 2008, as you can see here, has been used as our index year. You can also see different discount factors being used here. And obviously the decreasing values are here. These are the years. Now, NPV here is computed for 15, 20, and 25%, and is positive for all three. We have used the inter-rate ratio in order to assess the viability of the operations of the NIC ICO. When IRR, the inter-rate ratio, is 27.8, the NPV becomes zero. Hence, the use of 27.8 here, and of course, here as you can see, and the value dropping down to 1.5. Now, the rate of growth has been thought of as being 10%. However, This does not obviously account for risk and inflation. However, accounting for inflation in Iran is important because inflation itself is a significant number. And during the past 25 years, for example, the average inflation in Iran has been 20%. Therefore, adding these two is 30, and that leads to our final inference and our final conclusion that managing the company through this way is uneconomic. We believe that a systemic problem in the way in which government entities have been privatized exists, so much so that most of the privatization program procedures are being done very inefficiently. NICICO itself is a good example to this end. 40% of the shares have been decided to be allotted to the public, 20% of which were allotted to the public in 2007. However, and these were sold for 1.1 billion. However, these were sold to other state-owned entities, and they were all sold in 7 minutes. Therefore, no opportunity was given to private sector investors to invest in the NICICO. We believe that the first step towards reforming the current trend is enacting new strict rules coupled by meticulous enforcement. And obviously this is because we have to avoid the situation that occurred in the 80s in the Soviet Union, as I explained, during privatization. And we have evidence for that. Experience in other privatizations programs have shown that there is very good and ample public support. I'm sorry if I went over time. I thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Nikzad. We don't have time for questions, but I will say that a topic like this is quite important to us as appraisers if you're looking internationally. I've had numerous offers to do things in socialistic style economies, and it's really tough to work at how to help the country analyze the situation. Our next speaker is Richard Wyman.